universe is not afraid. I am a hurricane, listen to yourself, churn world, serve its own needs, dummy, serve your own needs, beat it up, an ox, speak, grunt, no strength, none matter, starts to clatter with fear, fight down, high choir in a fire, representing seven games in a government for hire in a combat site. Left to us and coming in a hurry with the furies breathing down your neck. My team reporters baffle Trump, tethered crop, look at that, no plane, fine, death, uh-oh, overflow, population, common food, what it'll do, save yourself, world, serve its own needs, listen to your heartbeat, dummy, with the rapture and the revenant, the right, right, you patriotic, patriotic, slam, fight, 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 feel it, pretty sight, it's the end of the world as we know it, it's the end of the world as we know it, it's the end of the world. TV hour, don't get caught in four tower, slice and burn, return, listen to yourself, churn, locking in, uniform and book, burning blood, letting every motive escalate, automotive, incinerate, light a candle, light a motor, step down, watch it heal, crush, crush, uh-oh, this means no fear, cavalier, renegade, steer clear, a tournament of lies, offer me solutions, offer me alternatives, and I decline, it's the end of the world as we know it.
South on Interstate 10. Interstate 10 is in a basin here that was created by the San Andreas Fault. On the right-hand side of the road, the San Jacinto Mountains. Elevation about 9,000 feet. These mountains on the Pacific Plate. On the opposite side are the San Bernardino Mountains. These mountains lie on the North American Plate. So what the San Andreas Fault has done is sheared these granitic mountains. A huge battlement that was once connected has now been sheared by the San Andreas Fault. Because the San Andreas Fault is cutting through these thick granitic mountains, this is why the San Andreas Fault is locked. So looking south here towards Coachella, when this segment of the San Andreas Fault moves, and it hasn't moved in 300 years, it has a lot of built-up potential energy. That stored energy, when it is released, could generate an 8.0 magnitude quake. That shockwave is going to travel from the Coachella Valley up along Interstate 10 here. These mountains on both sides are going to act like a funnel. And they're going to direct that energy straight at Los Angeles. And Los Angeles is a huge basin that's filled with sand, gravel, clay. And that basin is going to shake like a bowl of jelly. So this pass right here between Interstate 10, which actually separates the San Jacinto Mountains and the San Bernardino Mountains, these mountains are thick accumulations of granite. They have very deep roots that support the elevation. And because these granite mountains are so close, the shockwave generated by an earthquake is going to travel through this area, and these mountains are going to act like a funnel, and they're going to direct that energy right at the LA basin. So Los Angeles has a couple of major threats. One, the San Andreas Fault. This segment here from Cajone Pass to Coachella, which hasn't moved in over 300 years. Then there's a portion of the San Andreas Fault to the north and east of Los Angeles. That's another locked segment of the San Andreas Fault. And then underneath the basin of Los Angeles itself is the Pointe Hills Thrust Fault. So Los Angeles, way overdue for a major earthquake, and it's a matter of time. It's not a question when, is the question. We know for sure that an earthquake's gonna occur in Los Angeles. We just don't know when. And this is where earthquake prediction becomes a problem. We can say yes, within the next 100 years, there might be a major quake, but putting to a specific time is difficult. Looking at the large hotel, I would not want to be in that hotel during a major seismic event. So our next stop will be down in the Imperial Valley. We're going to travel down Interstate 10. We're going to look at the Salton Sea and the Imperial Valley. We're going to look at some pretty neat rocks there. There's some obsidian there, some pumice. There's a lot of geothermal activity, and I'll explain why that geothermal activity and why those volcanic rocks are there. So as we continue on this journey, we're looking up Interstate 10, going towards the north, and it's clear to see that on the west side of the highway are the snow-covered San Jacinto Mountains. On the east side of the snow-covered San Bernardino Mountains. So the San Bernardino Mountains earlier, those mountains are currently lost in basin. This basin was actually formed by the San Andreas Fault. So the strike slip motion of the San Andreas Fault has caused a shear action. Shearing has basically ripped the San Jacinto Mountains and the San Bernardino Mountains apart. As we go south, we're going to go into the Imperial Valley and take a look at the Salton Sea. So on this stop, we're looking at the Salton Sea. And you'll notice that in this region, the mountains are not close together. They're actually spread apart. And that's because this entire area is below sea level, and it's a tectonic valley that has been stretched and downdropped by the San Andreas Fault. So this is a strict contrast to the areas that we stopped first at. And as we look and pan towards the north, we can see the snow-covered mountains. Salton Sea is, the San Andreas Fault has moved. There's been historic earthquakes in 1940, and this valley is still being extended. It's below sea level. If you follow this down across the border, it goes into Mexico, and eventually it becomes the Sea of Cortez. Okay, I'm at the southern extent of the Sea of Cortez. Couple interesting things about this area. I'll pan around and you can see that the mountains are distal. They're far away. And that's because this is an extensional valley. This valley has been stretched and downdropped because there's three major tectonic faults that come around through this valley. The San Andreas, which is to the east. The San Jacinto, which is on the western side of the Salton Sea. And the Elsinore, which is just on the other side of the mountains. This area has been stretched so much that the Earth's crust is thin here, and it's below sea level. And throughout this region, there are power plants. Not a lot of cities in this area, but a lot of power plants. And the reason for that is that these power plants are geothermal. They use hot water. Throughout this region, the Imperial Valley and the Salton Sea, there are several hot springs that occur naturally. And these were natural hot springs. Since humans have come in and we started tapping into the resource, water table has dropped, and the geothermal sources also started to dry up. They now actually pump water into the ground. Because the Earth's crust is thin here, that water becomes superheated, rises up as hot thermal water to the point where it's boiling, because water boils about 212 degrees Fahrenheit. And they can use that energy to for a turbine to turn to generate electricity. But what's really interesting about this area, since this area has been very thinned out, a lot of volcanic activity. And we can see some of it right here. These rocks here are obsidian. Very shiny black obsidian. There's a lot of volcanic rock here, volcanic ash. This is an interesting rock where you have interbedded obsidian with pumice. And so all these volcanic rocks, I mean, look how big this piece of obsidian here. I'd like to take this back to the geology lab. It'd be cool to have a huge piece of obsidian like this. And there's several of these boulders all up and down the road here. Our next stop is going to be hopefully on top of a hill, and we'll look at the Imperial Valley from a little bit of an elevated point and take a look at the southern portion of the Sea of Cortez. So this is the most southern portion of the Salton Sea. This sea is currently drying up, so you can see that the shoreline used to be much higher, almost to where those picnic tables are, or that picnic table and the trash cans. And the Salton Sea right now is shrinking in size. That is in large part due to conservation efforts placed by the city of San Diego, or San Diego County. They have bought a lot of the water rights to the farms around this region. They're putting in sprinkler systems, a lot less flood irrigation is occurring, therefore you're gonna see a lot less runoff. And the Salton Sea, its level has been maintained for the past 70 years by agriculture runoff from the Coachella Valley and the Imperial Valleys. And as I walk around, you can just see throughout this landscape here, you see obsidian. There's a lot of volcanic rocks. So the red color rock, that's going to be a soft sediment, mostly shales. And then the darker rock with the shine to it over there is obsidian. And you literally find obsidian and pumice all over this area. So the reason we see these types of rocks is that obsidian is a volcanic rock that's extremely rich in silica. Lots of quartz. The black color is due to the iron. So iron, a little bit of iron, but mostly silicate. If you actually take an analyze this rock, pulverize it, run it through a mass spectrometer or something like that, the main component of this rock is quartz, SiO2. The dark color is due to the iron. So this is a very stretched out, elongated valley. Eventually what's going to happen as tectonic activity continues, the Sierra Cortez is going to meet the Imperial Valley. It's going to basically lower the Imperial Valley, much lower, to the point where the Sierra Cortez is going to move northward. It's going to merge with the Salton Sea. And it's all due to the tectonic activity of the San Andreas Fault, elongating the landscape. So this is a close-up view of one of these geothermal power plants. There's pipes throughout this area, and they're drilling water, pumping it up. They then inject it back into the ground. That water then becomes superheated. It is then goes to the power plant to turn a prop, which is hooked up to a generator. That generator then spins and produces electricity. There's a lot of geothermal activity in this part of the Imperial Valley. So this is the southern extent of the Salton Sea. There's actually active drilling going on, probably drilling for more geothermal resources. This area is just dotted with power plants. And the reason there's so much geothermal activity here is that this area has been stretched, downdropped, and stretched again throughout the last 20 million years, creating a very thin crustal section of the Earth, very close to magmatic activity, very close to the asthenosphere, the magmatic convection is occurring, and it's a good source of energy, kind of a natural source. This is another look at the Salton Sea. So I'm looking to the north right now, and there's some farm fields in the distance, and those farm fields off in the distance is Coachella. So we now are going to pan to the south. And as we do, you can see just how extensive the Salton Sea is. Pretty good size. And more importantly, how wide this valley is here. So this is it. Valley is widening, it's deepening, and this is all due to the tectonic activity of the San Andreas Fault. Our next stop is going to be the part of the San Andreas Fault that's locked, and that's the Cajone Pass. So we're going to go north right now, and we have two stops, one at Lost Lake and the other at Route 66, where the San Andreas Fault makes a 90 degree turn, and this is the part, that 90 degree turn, that has locked the San Andreas Fault. So this is Lost Lake. The San Andreas Fault goes right underneath this lake. It's kind of a strange area for the San Andreas Fault. This is Cajone Pass, I-15 in the background. So the San Andreas Fault flow goes right along those base of those mountains side of I-15, kind of makes a sharp turn, almost 90 degrees, transverses across the landscape through Lost Lake, and then it goes up and created a valley here, and this valley goes to the ski resort of Wrightwood. So again, this is a plate boundary between the North America plate and the Pacific plate. So everything that's on the right side of Lost Lake is on the North American plate. And these are the beginning of the San Gabriel Mountains. San Gabriel Mountains run all the way across just east of the Los Angeles Basin. They are the second fastest uplifting mountain range in the world today, and that's because of the San Andreas Fault. Because the San Andreas Fault makes this little curve right here, it's kind of pushing the San Gabriel Mountains back to the east, and that's resulting in an uplift. The only mountains that are growing faster than the San Gabriel Mountains are the Himalayan Mountains. So this is another shot of the San Andreas Fault. So our last and final stop, Old Route 66. So this is a highway that was built prior to I-15. It was the original highway that went between Los Angeles. There was no I-15. And like most highways in California, they took the path of least resistance when it came to going through mountains. In all cases, highways generally follow canyons or valleys. And those canyons, those valleys, those basins in between mountain ranges are caused by faults. And this one, caused by the San Andreas Fault. So this is old Route 66. It's also a pass for the railroads. But one of the interesting things about this particular stop is there's a rock formation here. And this is green schist. Kind of hard to tell in the... Okay, our last stop along this San Andreas Fault adventure. Call it a field trip. It's like, yeah, that sounds like something you have to attend. An adventure is something that people would pay to do. So this old Route 66, basically it went from Chicago to Los Angeles. It was the original corridor for transportation prior to the interstate system. So in the background, you'll see I-15. And in the foreground, we have old Route 66. And segments of that highway still exist. This highway, much like most highways in California, when they went through mountain areas like this, they took the path of least resistance, in that case a basin, and that basin was of course formed by the San Andreas Fault. So the San Andreas Fault sheared these mountains, created the pass that both Route 66 and the railroads, such as the Burlington Northern and Santa Fe, Union Pacific, use this route. Interesting thing about this particular spot here is there's a sequence of rocks here. These are metamorphic rocks. These are in the schist family, green schist in particular, and then further up the highway there's a regular schist. So this schist is here because these rocks have been subject to hydrothermal water, very hot water. At one time, these were buried deep. So in order to take a sedimentary rock and metamorphose it into a metamorphic rock like schist, you have to bury it pretty deep. So these rocks, sedimentary rocks, were buried, metamorphosed, and then uplifted along the San Andreas Fault. So the green schist is kind of a unique rock. It consists of a chlorate mineral. You can see the greenness in these hills. So it's a chlorite mica. And schists that are in the green facies can either be foliated or non-foliated. The non-foliated one we call green stone. The one that has foliation we call green schist. And I have a sample of that rock right here. So this is the green schist foliation. The white mineral in there is plagioclase. The green colorization is due to micas of chlorite. Not a whole lot of quartz. I see a small little bit of flakes of muscovite at the top here. So this basically concludes our field trip. And I just wanted to say that it's been kind of strange. We took courses that were face to face and we converted them to online. Kind of a strange situation. I'm sure everybody's tired of hearing about the coronavirus and how we're out to protect you and everything else. But let's focus on earthquakes. We saw what happened with the coronavirus. We saw people hoarding toilet paper, soaps, disinfectants, paper towels, noodles. Couldn't imagine some of the things that people hoarded, but they did, and they still continue to. Are you ready for an earthquake? I mean, who was ready for the coronavirus? I certainly wasn't. I think most people weren't ready for it. When we started this semester, we did not expect to take our face-to-face classes and to convert them online. It's been a real challenge, but we had to meet the criteria. We had to do it. Imagine today, a major earthquake, 8.0. How many people here are ready for an 8.0 earthquake? It'll be hard to get supplies, hard to get water. A lot of stores will be closed because they'll have damage to the buildings. And so on the Canvas webpage, I have put an earthquake preparedness kit. Start preparing for earthquakes now. Get yourself a kit together. Non-perishable foods, a radio, batteries, flashlight, blankets, tents. I have a whole list on Canvas. Please get ready for the earthquake. It's not a question as if California's gonna have a major quake. It's a question of when. And remember, keep this in mind. Noah built the ark before the rain. Don't get caught building your ark in the middle of the rain. Thank you.